All right, welcome back. So today we will be continuing our STEM programming of the simple risk club Wagner learning model. So the last week we talked about how to implement the simple risk club Wagner model in STEM for only one participant, right? So STEM is a block-based language. We have the model block, that is the likelihood, that's the core part. But before we were actually coding the model block, we also have to specify the known part, which is the data, and the unknown part, which is the parameter. So we have the data block, parameters block, and then the model block, and then everything is complete, and then we could run that. And in the real scenario, in the real world scenario, we never recruit only one participant. Instead, we recruit multiple participants to test the average effect. So we briefly talked about two alternatives to feed data from multiple participants. So one way is to treat the multiple people, those individuals, as if they are a single person. And a second way to feed multiple participants is that we feed all of the data individually. And then we thought that, well, both of the two approaches, they are working not really ideally. And we find that combining both of the two might be an ideal solution, in the sense that we would like to keep the commonality in the first place, because presumably, if we are testing healthy participants, they are very likely that coming from the same group, the same population. And on the second hand, they are also different people. So we would like to keep their individual differences. So then there will be the hierarchical structure. So there is umbrella, there is overarching populational level distribution that considers or that depicts the commonality of the participants. And then the lower level is the individual participants, where they still have their own individual differences. So today we will be looking at the hierarchical model in a little bit more detail. Great. One more part, that's done. So I hope you follow me, and then you also thought about what we have learned from the last week. And today's topic will be about hierarchical modeling. And it deals with like the model part, and also deals with here. This section deals with the model part, and also deals with the model estimation or the model fitting part. Great. So we skipped this part last week, and then now we could come back. So why we use hierarchical modeling? So one advantage is, as I described, yes, it combines both the populational level and the population level and the individual level. That sounds plausible, because that's how the participants, or how the individuals are structured in the society, right? There's the population, and then there's the individual. And there is also a computational advantage or benefit of using hierarchical model, in the sense that, in short, it is more likely to achieve a stable and precise model estimation. Whereas if using maximum likelihood, it's quite biased by outliers. So let me show you what that means. So previously, some people here, actually we wrote a paper together, the package paper. So he simulated some experimental data. And as we've seen many times, if we are simulating something, we know the ground truth. So we are the person who is doing the simulation, and we know the ground truth, okay? So here, shown in black circle, those are the true values for the simulation. On the x-axis, that's the participants from 1 to 30, and on the y-axis, that is the parameter value, okay? Black is the fitted. Black is the true parameter, and then we use the true parameter to generate data, and then we could feed the model to the generated data using two approaches. So one is the hierarchical Bayesian approach, the other one is the maximum likelihood estimation. So here the hierarchical approach is shown in blue square, and then the maximum likelihood results, they are shown in this yellow-orange triangle shape. So what you can see is basically to see, well, if the model estimation technique is working properly, then the estimated results will match the truth, the ground truth. Okay, this is what we're looking for in this kind of graph. But you see here, the difference per participants between the black circle, the true parameter, and the orange triangle, this maximum likelihood estimates, the difference is pretty large, honestly. So it's visible, and it's something that we cannot really ignore. And in other words, the fitting results using maximum likelihood is not precise or accurate or reliable. And if we focus our results by using maximum likelihood estimation, then all the other follow-up or subsequent analysis might be really biased because the result is not trustworthy, reliable. What is good instead is that if we look at the difference between the hierarchical Bayesian approach shown in blue and the black circle, the same thing. So we look at the difference between the black and the blue. So you see here most of the time, so the blue color really matches the black ground truth. So in other words, in short, the parameter estimation results from the hierarchical Bayesian approach is much more accurate and it is more reliable. And then the variance, it is also smaller relative to using maximum likelihood estimation. Okay. So here, this using simulation, we show that there is indeed an advantage of using hierarchical Bayesian approach relative to the maximum likelihood estimation, especially when there is a structure of the data, okay? And then this one, so the hierarchical approach, what does the hierarchical mean? I told you already, but let's just revisit this idea. So hierarchical basically means there are multiple levels, multiple layers, multiple hierarchies. And basically, this can also be associated with other kind of terminology that you are familiar with, I guess. So I guess if you have heard about the term linear mixed effect model, so there is something called mixed effect model, and then you know there is the division between fixed effect and the random effect. So then if we use a fixed effect and random effect together, then they are mixed. So then that's where the name comes from, right? So hierarchical approach is most of the time hierarchical approach is most of the time interchangeable with mixed model because they have multiple layers and they have multiple structures. So here the fixed effect part is actually so in the sense that all participants are fitted with the same set of parameters. It's the same idea when we were talking about treating multiple participants as if they are a single person. Okay, so this is the fixed part. This is the commonality part. And then the random part is, well, then each subject is fitted independently of each other. And this basically means we fit just all of them independently, regardless of the common structure. And what we do if we mix them, so fixed together with random, so then they're fixed, and then that's the hierarchical structure of the model. And then this one I showed you already on the lecture last week. So suppose that those are individuals from some common population, and then if we fit the data as if they are a single person, so using the fixed approach, and then here that's the illustration, and if we fit all of them individually, that's the illustration below. And we mentioned that both of them, they are usually not ideal, right? So here, if we fit all of them as if there's the one person, the fixed approach, it is quite biased. and if we fit all of them individually, then it's sparse. We lose the common information among the individuals. So by combining them, the hierarchical approach is basically superimpose a higher level population distribution, assuming so where all those participants, where all those individuals are coming from. So there is a common population, and then they are drawn from the same normal distribution. So this is the idea, okay? And when we fit, you see here there's the difference, right? So when here is the original one, and then here there's the higher level population distribution. You see, especially this guy and then this guy. So they are pushed a little bit into the center of the group level distribution, to the mean a little bit, to the group level distribution. So then this is also a way to regularize outliers. And this is actually, this is not bad in practice. This doesn't mean that the outliers are dragged towards the center. It never goes really towards the center of the mean. It goes a little bit forward. So in the direction of the center, but never really into the center. So this effect of the hierarchical approach is not that strong. Also depends on how you specify the prior. But basically what I'm trying to say that this approach is also a good approach to regularize outliers, if you have outliers. Good. Perfect. And then this effect is called shrinkage effect, because the outliers are shrinked towards the mean of the group level distribution. Okay, good. Are there any questions so far? Conceptual level? Okay, so far so good, I guess. As I showed you already, the common approach by applying this hierarchical structure is to have a normal distribution, because this is one that's are used often, and then we see normal distribution here and there pretty much everywhere, right? For example, weight and height and IQ and many things, they follow the normal distribution. And this is also the first attempt to have to give the population distribution. And if you have, if you do have some knowledge about the distribution of the group, instead of the normal distribution, you are free to use other shape of the distributions instead of the bell shape, okay? So here, let me start from here. So the bottom one, the Y1, Y2, YN, and Y capital N, so they are individual data points, let's say, they are the data, okay? And then here in the middle, theta 1, theta 2, until theta capital N, they are individual level parameters. So suppose if we only have this row and this row, that basically means individual fitting. So individual data only supports the parameter estimation for that individual, if we only have these two lines. And then if we do want to have a hierarchy, so if we would like to have a higher level of hierarchy, so then we say, well, there is a capital phi that governs all of the commonality of the parameters, theta 1 until theta capital N, okay? So then that conceptually means for each parameter of that single person, the parameter estimation results does not only come from the individual data. So here the individual data is supporting the parameter estimation for that individual, but the individual parameter is also supported by the higher level, okay? So here you see the arrow sign, and then these two information, group level information, the group level regularization, let's say, and also here the individual level data, together they govern the information of the individual parameter fitting, okay? Good. And you might just wonder, so where do we estimate, how do we estimate the parameter of the population level? Where does that come from? Well, in fact, the individual information is coming from all those individuals. The group level information is coming from all those individuals. So you see here the arrows, they are bi-directional. So everything is happening simultaneously. Yeah, with the color, I guess everything is a little easier. So let me do that again. So here we have individual data supporting the individual level parameter estimation, and then this is also supported by the group. And then this one actually also tells or educates or informs the group level distribution. And then this group information is now regularizing the individual of another one, of another parameter. And then this individual parameter is, again, of course, supported by its own data point, okay? So I'm saying the way I'm describing this is that everything happens like step by step, but it's not everything. So here, all those arrows in this color, so all those arrows, they happen all at the same time, simultaneously. So this is, excuse me. That is the advantage of using that. So if you read papers, then you will see people in the method section, then say, we apply the hierarchical Bayesian approach, which simultaneously estimate both the group level parameters and the individual level parameters. And then this is in fact, indeed people what people write in their article, in their paper. Good. So we go a little bit more into detail. Once that we know how this works, we can replace the capital theta with something a little bit more concrete. So we said we use normal distribution, and the normal distribution has only two parameters. So one is the mean of the parameter, and the other one is the variance, the standard deviation of the distribution. So this is nothing new, we know that already, right? And then this goes back and forth, great. So graphically, I'm trying to show you all different ways of specifying the hierarchical model. So here, this one you see, and then a second approach is basically to write that down, okay? And this one, we could go a little bit slower. So P is for probability, and this one is basically the Bayesian equation. And we are interested in the posterior of the capital theta here, and the small theta here, given the data. So this is the posterior, right? Posterior of some parameter given the data. And instead of one set of parameters, here we have one set of parameter for individual and another set of parameter for the group. So here we have both the capital theta and the small theta. Writing this in the shape of the Bayes equation is relatively easy. So you see here, well, the posterior equals to the prior multiplies the likelihood and divided by the normalizing term, okay? So this is something we know already. And what we do not know yet is basically how to deal with this thing. So what is this one and what is this? So how to spell out the prior and also the likelihood, because there is the joint probability part, theta, small theta and capital theta, but how to specify the structure. So the structure is basically looking at here. So I mentioned once that when you look at this kind of the chain of conditional probabilities, the best way to read this equation is to read from the right hand side, sorry. So the best way to read this equation is to read from the right-hand side. Here, the very right one, the rightmost, it is the P of the capital theta. So this is the prior of the population, okay? So if this is the prior of the population, what does it mean to have a P of small theta given capital theta? Well, then this is the hierarchical structure. So this means probability of individual parameters given the group level parameter, okay? So here, this term, you can say this is the prior of group, and this one, this term in the middle, it is the prior of the individuals. And when we have the individual parameters, given that, how does the data look like? This is our common form for the likelihood, and we know that one already. So you see here, this is really not too difficult, too complex to read. Group level prior, individual level prior, and the likelihood, okay? And then the normalizing term is not really important, and we can get rid of it. So the posterior is proportional to the product between likelihood, individual prior, and group prior. Okay, good, perfect. So here, this is easier to understand. So graphically, we see, well, this is the group level distribution. Normal, there is a mean, there's a variance, and all those individuals, they are following this distribution, okay? And important to mention is that all those individuals, they are not a single value. We cannot say we use only we only use a single number to describe the individual. So all those individuals, they are also distribution, right? Because we are using the Bayesian approach, everything is a distribution. So here the individual distribution, they follow this. Okay. So you might wonder, so how can these individuals follow the group distribution? In fact, it is the mean of each individual population, more or less following the group. So this idea can be illustrated here. So we have a group distribution, okay? There is some mean, and then there is some variance, standard deviation. So all of the individual means, so they follow roughly the group level distribution. And they could, in fact, have their own different variance. And even the shape can also be asymmetrical. That's totally accepted, okay? But in general here, the mass of the distribution at the individual level, they follow the group level distribution. Good. And then you perhaps wonder something else, because we are using the Bayesian parameter estimation approach, we are under this framework. What is missing? What is missing is the prior, right? Where does the prior come from? So here, the individuals, they follow the group. This illustration is effectively or technically the same as the center part. So only the middle part of the equation. So what is the P of small theta given the capital theta? Then that's this one, right? What is this? What is the P of capital theta? So that is the really the prior. And really people say that hyperprior or hyperparameter, the prior of hyperparameter. Whatever that is, that basically means the prior of the group level distribution. So what do we need? We have a mean here for group level distribution, and we have a standard deviation for the group level distribution. We need the prior for the mu, and we need the prior for the sigma. So that is, so basically we have to give two priors. We can use something like this for the prior mu, and we can something like this for the prior sigma. And then they formulate the group level normal distribution, and here they are the individual level distributions. Great. Questions? Everything's fine. So far, so good. Yeah. Okay, good, perfect. So if you are okay with this idea, the hierarchical structure, so now we go back to our exact example. So we go back to our concrete reinforcement learning, the Riskla-Wagner value updates. So here, this is the graphical illustration of fitting multiple individuals all independently, right? So here we have the trial loop, we have the participant loop, and each participant, the alpha and tau, they have their own parameters. So here there's this subject index I. So just basically imagine on this graph, so how can we make it hierarchical? Okay, so the question is, what nodes do you want to add to include so that this graphical illustration becomes a hierarchical model? So the hint is basically that we have parameters and we need a group level mean of that parameter and we need a group level standard deviation of that parameter. So then we can just look at here, what parameters do we have? We have a learning rate, the alpha and the Riskla-Wagner value updates. We have a tau here for the choice rule, for the softmax, for the sigmoid rule, whatever that is, the slope, the stiffness. So to make it hierarchical, we only need a mean and a variance of the learning rates. And to make the second parameter hierarchical, we apply the same idea that we will use a mean and a standard deviation of the tau parameter. So that is, you see here, when we have these two parameters together with these two parameters, everything becomes a hierarchical structure. Good. Great, now we have the hierarchical model. So we have the hierarchical model graphically as straightforward as that. And now we have to go a little bit one step backward to ask ourselves, so how did we get here? So how did we get from a single, how did we get from feeding a single participant's data to feeding the data all hierarchically? So we have, so we have the model here for one individual, for one single person, and here we fix we use the model fitting in a fixed effect way. So we treat all of the participants as if they are a single person, and we feed all of them all independently, right? So this is the second approach of feeding multiple participants. And then lastly, we have the hierarchical model. So what you can see here, the difference between among all of the models is basically how the parameters are fitted. So you see here, this is only one person, here multiple people, but the parameters are the same. So here multiple people, well, they have their own parameters. And then here, even though those people, they have their own parameters, but this parameter, they are governed by a higher level group distribution. Okay, so all of them, they only differ in the sense that how the parameters are estimated, if there is a structure and how to implement it, okay? The model itself is the same. So all of them, they share the single part, they share this part. This part is the same across all of the four models, okay? So then that basically means, well, the model is the same, and then they only depends, they only differ in the sense of how the parameters are fitted, okay? I think that makes sense. Good. So the next question is simply, well, when we have the graphical illustration of the model, as usually, what do we do? So we will then implement the model in our favorite Stan language, okay? So before we do that, we actually have to write down a few things. So this one is basically the quantification of the priors of the model. So let's start from something that we know already. So we know the value updates, and we know the action selection, and then these two lines are the core part. So these two lines is basically the model part, what is actually the meat of the model. Everything above, they are the priors, okay? So we could start, so here everything is prior. We could start from here. So we say, well, the learning rates, the mu of the learning rates, this one. What kind of prior information can we use? Not too difficult, the learning rate, right? This is something that we quantify the lower end and upper end. So uniform distribution between 0 and 1, great. Here, the group level sigma, the group level standard deviation. What prior can we use? So recall when we were fitting the regression model, so I showed you most of the case, most people, they prefer to use a half Cauchy distribution for this variance parameter. So here we basically use a half Cauchy, okay? And if you wonder what half Cauchy means, well, maybe we don't have time today. We have the slides and you can go back. So we mentioned half Cauchy when we were talking about regression. Here, the mu of tau, this one, as I said earlier, so we arbitrarily gave the upper bound 3. So then this one also follows a uniform distribution between 0 and 3. And then this 3 can be replaced with some other values, for example, 5 for 10. So 10 is usually used in real life practice research. Okay, good. This one, the sigma here, again, half Cauchy distribution. Great. So these four lines, they are the prior of the group level parameters. Mean variance. One for the learning rate, the other one for the tau. These two lines, they are the prior of the individual level parameters. So we know that the individual levels, they follow a normal distribution with this mean and with this variance, these three together, right? And then the tau, the same idea, each individual tau, they are also followed by a normal distribution with this mean and this variance. Okay. And we have a little trouble here. And we know that the normal distribution, there's no boundary. So normal distribution, the theoretical limit is basically, well, no limit from negative infinity to positive infinity. However, our parameter, we want it to have some kind of constraint. So the individual learning rates, we know by definition, it is a number between 0 and 1. But the learning rate doesn't, but the normal distribution doesn't support kind of a range between 0 and 1. So what do? Well, we can truncate it. So this is the idea. So there is the normal distribution with no lower and upper bounds, and we have two cutoffs, one at the lower bound and the other one at the upper bound. So we basically only take the mass, the density of the normal distribution between 0 and 1 for the learning rates. Okay, so this T here, this is different than this one. Those are different numbers, different letters. So here, this one means truncate. So I only want the part of the normal distribution between 0 and 1, okay? And similarly, here I truncate again the normal distribution, and this case, this time I want the density to be lie within 0 and 3, okay? And if we have the boundary, we have the truncation. And then the little problem is solved. So we know that the parameter range is okay and everything's fine, okay? Good. So now here at the right-hand side, I am showing you how to implement this hierarchical structure in STEM. Again, we start from something we know already. So what do we know? We know here in the model block, we have the participant loop, looping from the first to the last participant, and we have the trial loop, looping from the first to the last participant. And I told you that the core part, the central, the meat of the model is never changed. So it is always a simple risk lambda. And then this part is essentially the same as before. We don't really have to change anything. So what we change is, well, then here, okay? And these four lines, they are the implementation of this square. So again, we can start from the bottom. So the learning rate, individual ones, they follow normal distribution with the mean variance. Good. The tau follow a normal distribution, individual ones follow normal distribution, the mean and variance of the tau. Okay, good. And then the individual level is like this, and then the group level, the standard deviation, these two guys, they follow the Cauchy here. Okay, good. And where is the half Cauchy, and where are these uniform distributions? Well, we have to go up, go to the top. So we see here, these two parameters here, these two, right? They have a lower boundary of 0. So then we take, that means we only take the positive half. So then this is the half Cauchy. And well here, and the learning rate mu and tau mu, we have the boundary, okay? And as long as we write this way, we do not have to give the uniform distribution prior, the uniform prior in the model block. Because if we take the derivative, everything's constant, we do not really have to write it, okay? So there is an implicit uniform distribution as long as we write this way. I guess this is clear. We mentioned this multiple times. Good. And so lastly, where is the truncation? Okay, how do we apply the truncation? Here, so all those individual level learning rates and individual level tau parameters, we also give the boundary. So here 0, 1, so here 0, 1. So even though I write down here that they follow a normal distribution, but this part only takes values or densities between 0 and 1, and for the tau between 0 and 3. I give you 1 minute to think about the model, okay? And also think about questions if you have. So I'm giving you the whole picture now. Here, that's the graphical illustration of the hierarchical model of the simple risk Lavagna. So here are the equations, the formulas. If you write paper, you write this way. And if you want to implement, you implement in this way. So the model part is always the same. So what we change is the prior and how the parameters are specified or declared. So what is different is actually that the truncation parts, it is not usually applied in real. What I mean is that if you really give the truncation, you will see some problems. So in the sense that we know the normal distribution, there is no lower boundary, there is no upper boundary. If we have an artificial or arbitrary boundary of the normal distribution, it is bad, right? We know the normal distribution is like a continuous shape. And then we have two cuts, one lower and one upper. Well, why do we do this? So if you imagine that we have this kind of thing, then it will really cause problem. So you could imagine that the MCMC traveler, when it is trying to sample from a normal distribution, if everything's smooth, it continues, the MCMC traveler basically tries to sample from everywhere. So even though the place with the higher density, the traveler samples more often relative to the place where the density is low, but the sampler is still trying to go somewhere where the density is low, right? And then if you have a boundary, if you basically close the door, and then the MCMC sampler does not go to the other side of the distribution of the world, and then basically the sampler is trying to hit the door, and then this heat can cause you many problems, and then this heating thing is like trying to go through, trying to go against the door. It's really troublesome. Okay, as you could imagine, this really is not a good appropriate behavior of the. Well, it is appropriate, but it is not desired behavior from our perspective. Also from the sampler's perspective, I guess. Good. All right. So what I'm trying to say is that, well, implementing the hierarchical model this way is straightforward. It's quite easy to understand. But practically, when we feed the model to the data in this way, we will really see how to say this. So people, I think they call it pathological model behaviors. So basically, the models are the IEO, okay? You will see a lot of warnings and the model does not converge well and you will have troubles. But that doesn't mean the model is wrong. That only means the model is not optimized. And then optimization is basically the next topic of our lecture. But before we really move into the optimization section of the seminar, do you have any questions at this point? Great. And by the way, the programming project, the programming exercise, we will be using hierarchical models. And do not do this way. So I will show you later how to do it properly. So how we could optimize the hierarchical structure so that everything is working fine. Okay. Good. So if you do not have questions, the exercise, I suggest you to do it at home, because I said this model is problematic. If you fit it, you will see warnings, guaranteed. For example, here, so when I was fitting the model using the approach I showed you just one slide earlier, the program basically says, well, there were 97 divergent transitions after warm-up, and this one might help, might not, okay? So we basically see, so this reflects the idea that the sampler is trying to go against the door, and but the door is closed, the sampler does not, cannot go outside. Great. So this is the parameter estimation results. And this one doesn't really make sense too much. So because I changed a lot of things and then to make it nicer. And if you really use the default, and then this really doesn't look very nice. But I tell you later what this means. Okay, good. So here, this one makes sense. This one we could take a look at the differences. We know that the data for this simple learning task, button price A and B, and we get reward or no reward, we simulated the data. That means we know the ground truth. We simulated using a set of learning rates, and we simulated using a set of tau temperature. And here, this graph, they are the ground truth. And then this approach is fitting all the individuals independently without a hierarchical structure, okay? And then this one is using the hierarchical structure. You see here the variance is a lot reduced from here to here, and also from here to here, okay? But then you see there is also not too ideal, and quite largely because the model is not optimized, and then we see later how to optimize the model. Well, not later, now, I guess. Yeah, before I go to the model optimization, so here I show you the ground truth. So here, this line is the ground truth of the simulation. So we simulated the learning rates with a mu of 0.6 and with a standard deviation of 0.12. And for the tau parameter, we simulated using a mean of 1.5 and a standard deviation with 0.2, okay? So those are the ground truth. And then this table, so they are the parameters estimated using the hierarchical approach. And we see the mean is this, and then for this one is that in blue, in green, sorry. And then the standard deviation here in blue, and also here. You see the match pretty well. So basically, hierarchical approach is really able to recover the parameters. And I also did the parameter estimation using maximum likelihood, and then this match up doesn't really work very well. Basically, they don't really match well. And then this speaks for the same idea that when we are using hierarchical approach, the results are more accurate and reliable. Okay, good. Yeah, you know the color. Great. Now this brings us to the next topic. And then this might be a little bit more technical relative to the topics we have seen earlier, we have heard earlier. But just bear with me. I think this is not really very difficult to understand. And I will also go a little bit slower. So optimizing the STEM program basically means we can make it more efficient, okay? And this is true for nearly every programming language, because if you are trying to implement one idea, well, you first write it down, okay? But that might not be as efficient as if you do it with some kind of optimization. But it's not bad. So the first time when you are translating some idea from textbook, from a paper into a code, your goal is to make it work. Okay, this is always, I tell me, well, if I do something in the first time, I just let it work. That is my goal. I let it work. And then I see, well, I test, how long does that take? Does that maybe take 10 to 15 minutes? or does that take 3 to 10 hours? Well, if only 5 to 10 minutes, I don't have to optimize because that works, and then that doesn't take long. I'm happy and everyone's happy. But if that works, however, yet that takes too long, then that might be a sign that you will optimize your code. Okay, so then after it's running, after everything works, your second goal is to improve it, to change the efficiency, to change everything, to vectorize, and to use some of the tips that I will show you here to optimize your code. Okay, good. So after optimizing the stand code, I summarize usually four main ways. There are multiple. And if you look at the stand manual, the reference, the PDF, they listed multiple, more than I will introduce you here. But these four I show you here, they are the four most common ones. So optimizing, first approach, pre-process your data. And second, specify a proper model. Third, vectorizing. And fourth, reparameterizing. Okay, I will show you one by one. Don't worry if you don't know what I mean, what those terms they mean. Good. Pre-process the data. In other words, that means Stan is a language that does the model fitting, that doesn't do some other, let me put it in another way. So Stan is the place where you do model estimation. It is not the place where you do some simple calculation. And if you want to do simple calculation, do it outside, don't let Stan do it. It's basically like you are using a huge hammer to nail with some like little nails. So you basically overuse the tool. This is what I'm trying to say. So when you want to reshape or reprocess or pre-process of your data, it's better to do it outside of Stan. So when we have the example of the second order polynomial regression, we use weight and weight squared to predict heights. We could, in one way, calculate the square term in Stan, and we could alternatively calculate the square term outside Stan in R, right? So in R, we could say, well, the data, we have another field called squared, and then we calculate the square. And then we collect every data point, including height, weight, first order, and weight, second order, into the same data list, because this is the data list that we will parse from R to Stan. Okay, good. And then in Stan, we can already use the second order weight. Instead, we have to write another block, how that's called? The pre-processed data block to do this kind of thing, right? So one, to keep it short, Stan is the place to do the estimations. All the other stuff, as long as you can do it in R, don't do it in Stan. So this is the idea. Great. So the second approach is to specify a proper model. So this one is in fact one of the most difficult approach to estimate the model. So because what I mean is that if you have some kind of the data and if you have some kind of the model, if the model does not approximate the data at all, so how could you obtain a reliable model fitting? But then this is in fact called model misspecification. So let me repeat the idea. So you have some data, you have some of the model. Your goal is to approximate the data using some model. However, if the model cannot approximate the data at all, and then this is a mismatch. And then this is model misspecification. You misspecify a model to approximate something that is not the case in reality. And the question for us practically basically means, how do we come up with a proper model? How can I know that? So this is always the question. And I guess I remember that I recall that you keep asking me, so how do I know what kind of model do I use? And we touched upon this idea last week. So the first thing that you ask yourself is, what's the data type you have? Do you have continuous? Do you have discrete? And when you know this classification, discrete versus continuous, you go forward, there's a decision tree. And I also told you that, well, in our field, there are not too many distributions that you have to remember. You have normal distribution, you have the binomial distribution, and then there is the categorical distribution we've seen so far. And then that's it, okay? But knowing the distribution is only half of the story, because the Riesz-Klein-Wagner model, if you don't know, how can you know about it? So the question here is that you need to have a little bit background knowledge. So we call this expert knowledge. So we are expert, you are the expert, and you know best what is a proper model for your task. So the model might not be the best, but you know where to start with. So the example is we have the two-armed bandit machine task, two options and reward, no reward. We know the Riesz-Klein-Wagner model is a good starting point. And if we want to improve it, how can we do? Well, the Riesz-Klein-Wagner is a good starting point. What we do is that we change it a little bit. So we make variants of the Riesz-Klein-Wagner. Maybe we use two learning rates instead of one learning rate. And maybe we change how the prediction error is encoded. So instead of the two parameter, we could use something like an absolute prediction error, regardless of the sign. So something like this, maybe stupid, but we have a starting point, and then we go forward to model it properly. Okay, so go back to here, specify a proper model. First thing to do, if you really have no idea what to do, so first step is visualize your data to see some patterns. So in our learning task, plot the learning curve to see how the behavior look like from the participants. And follow the literature. So look at the literature in this kind of task, what are the models that have been used by previous literatures, by previous researchers? And start from simple, then build the complexities. In our example, we can start from a very simple Riesz-Klein-Wagner model, and then we can make it as complex as we wish. So multiple parameters, multiple learning rates, and depends on conditions, we can have this, we can have that, and everything as long as you wish. But do not start with the most complex one you have. Start with simple, and then add a little bit complexity one at a time. So then in this way, you do not really lose track for yourself. In other words, you are doing a favor for your future self. Good. So another idea is to simulate data and then run model recovery. The simulate data we have seen, so we just simulate data using the ground truth that we know, and then we could fit the model to the generated data to see if the model can be identified. And then this is a good approach to see if the model is okay or not. So model recovery, perfect. Any questions? So this tool is relatively easy, right? Pre-process your data, do as much as you can outside STEM, and then specify a model. Okay, good. And then once you have done this, and once you have specified a model, then we go to some technical details, how to optimize the STEM code. Vectorizing. The vectorizing we have seen not too many, but we indeed have seen some kind of examples of vectorizing. So vectorizing in short means you can take the advantage of linear algebra, and instead of writing a loop, you can just write everything in one line or in a fewer lines, as opposed to when you are writing in a loop. So here we have seen this example. So when the coin flipping is following a Bernoulli distribution, and coin flipping, it is a vector of multiple elements. instead of writing the for loop, you can write the line like this. So this then means all of the coin flipping, they follow the same Bernoulli process, the same Bernoulli distribution. And another example is when we specify, just a few seconds ago, a few minutes ago, so when we specify the individual level prior of a risk Wagner model. So here the learning rates and the tau, both of them, they are, they have multiple elements. The learning rate one means the learning rate of the first person, and learning rate two means the learning rate of the second person. So here, this learning rate, this is not a single scalar, it has multiple values. And we do not have to write a for loop to say each of the learning rates with index is following the normal distribution. Instead, we write in one line that all of them, they follow the same normal distribution. Okay, good. And then the last example is actually what we have seen when we were doing regression, predicting the height with a weight. So the first attempt is basically writing a loop. As I said, the first attempt to make everything just work, okay? It works. We have a loop and we have the mu calculation, and then this follows normal. And then the second thought is perhaps, well, there's a loop, can I get rid of it? Yes. So because there's a normal distribution and you do not really have to write the for loop, you can just do everything like here. And we have a third line. The third line is really to compact everything into one line. And this is also possible. Yeah, great. And in real research is not that, so the first thing you really, you make it work, this is the first attempt. And then afterwards, instead of running it to see how long that takes, you could use some of the knowledge that I will cover now to see, to check, is there anything that you can optimize? So for example, if you have a model that works in the first place, it's very good, that's congratulations. And then check, are there any loops that you can get rid of? Are there any places that you think which is coded a little bit dirty, but you would like to make it a little bit more elegant? So those are the places that you can go into and then optimize and then run and then maybe debug. So this process iterates quite a few times. Okay, and the debugging is another issue that we will cover later next week. Good. So if there's no more problem or questions, I will then spend the rest of the lecture today on the topic of reparameterization, because this is something that is not really familiar to many of you, I guess. And this might be a little bit technical. So let's see. So reparameterization, what that means, that basically means to parameterize your model in a different way, right? So reparameterize your model. To illustrate, I will use example from the stand manual, and then the example has a name. It is called the Niels funnel. So the Niels funnel follows this mathematical equation. And what I can tell you is that you don't really have to know what that is. This is really not important. This is something a little bit complex on purpose. And let's see how we can optimize the STEM model for that, okay? So even though that looks like a little bit scary, so not, don't worry, you don't really have to know that. But in the case where you do wonder what that means, it is nothing much than a normal distribution. So here, let's look at everything one by one. This is a normal distribution, there's a y, and then the mean is zero, and the standard deviation is three. Well, simple, right? This basically means y, there is the random variable y, and the y is following a normal distribution with a mean of zero and with a standard deviation of three. That's it, okay, good. And then we look at this part. This is a little bit complex, but it is also nothing else but a normal distribution. So there is a normal, and then this random variable is called x, and then there is not only one, but nine x's. So here, and from one to nine, okay? And each of the x, they are following a normal distribution again with a mean of zero and with a standard deviation of half of y and then take the exponents. Good. And every of the x random variable, you then take the multiplication. So here this capital pi means in Greek letters, capital pi means multiplication. Okay, good. Great. So this multiplication part, we don't have to worry, and we know that they are just normal distributions. Great, we know that, that's easy. And if you plot the density, the marginal density out of two dimensions, so one dimension of x together with y and also on the log scale, you see this looks like a funnel, and then that's where or how the name comes from. Good. So good. So even though that we don't have to know this, but what is important to know is that the shape of the distribution. So we know that looks like a funnel, and then we have to link this shape to some knowledge that we have known, that we have acquired already. That is, what is our goal? Our goal is always to sample from the posterior distribution, or just sample from the distribution. And then this funnel shape is the target distribution that we would like to sample from. And how to sample from the distribution? We use MCMC sampler. And how does the MCMC sampler move? How does the MCMC sampler travel on a density graph? It proposes steps, step sizes, okay? So it proposes steps, where to go, direction, and it also proposes how large each step is going to be. So now I guess you can already see the problem or the challenge here. This one is really tiny, it's really thin. There's basically one line here. And imagine you have a proper step size for here. Great, basically small step size. And it then will be too little, too tiny for the density up here. So if you have a proper step size here, that's okay. And then it will take ages, just nearly forever to sample the density here. And even though the density is low, you do not really sample from there, but it has to be sampled so that you know they have a low density. Great. Conversely, if you have a proper sample size, a step size here, upper, if you have a proper step size here, maybe large, and you could imagine this relatively large proper step size for this area is too large for the lower part for the tail. So then it will cause problem. Okay, so this is the place why the STEM people, they chose this example on purpose to illustrate the idea of the reparameterization. Okay, but anyway, let's just write it down and then to see how that looks like. So interestingly, implementing these guys into STEM is surprisingly straightforward. So we have the x and y, they are not data, they are just variables. So there is a real number y, and then there is a vector of 9 elements of x. Okay, y and x, easy. And y here, this one, it follows the normal with 0 and 3 as the input parameters. Great. And the x-axis, not x, sorry. So the x parameter is following, again, a normal distribution vectorized, right? Each of them, they are following a normal with mean of 0 and with the standard deviation of this, okay? The same as here. Great. And you might just wonder how to do this multiplication. Well, if you do everything in this way, you will have already a joint parameter space, and then there is kind of the multiplication, so you don't have to worry about that. But that's why I say, well, implementing this instead is surprisingly easy. Okay, good. And then if you implement this one, so this is like the first attempt that I told you. So if you see something, if you want to implement it instead, first attempt, write it down and make it work. good, and it should work. And then let me show you later. I'm sorry. Yeah, here. This is good. So the first attempt, it works. So everything works, but it might not be ideal. Okay, it might not be ideal. So what that means? So when we feed the model to the data, and if we look at the trace plots of the x and y parameters. In this case, I plot y, and you see here the first attempt, that basically just the work version, the trace plot doesn't really look good. So what usually we are looking for is something like this. So all those MCMC chains, they mix pretty well, and then there's no divergence. So you see here, there is a solid darker purple line, and then it's really divergent. It is really off relative to the others, and all the others are off basically. And if you remember, the R hat statistics, we're aiming for something close to one, okay? This is a good example. And this one, the first just working version, is really not a good idea. So 1.22 is too high. And this one, the second row, it is the number of effect samples. How many do we have? We have just by default 4,000 effective samples. And out of the 4,000, only 18 are valid samples. This is not good, as you can see. Runtime-wise, well, these three, I can tell you later what this means, but runtime-wise, so how long does that take? Not too long, that's okay, 50 seconds. What matters is the number of effect samples per time unit. You basically divide this one by this one, and then you see, well, per seconds, I only obtain not even half a valid sample. And then there are quite some numbers of divergence. So this is not good, okay? So I showed you the first attempt, which is the just working version, which is not good. And this is showing you how bad that can be. And then the next question is simply how to optimize the model. Now let's go back. Good. There's a question. So the vector of 9x here creates sort of a loop over x1 over 9. Yeah, you can imagine that there is an internal loop, but you don't have to write it down. Yeah. And when this line is executed, there is no loop actually. So it takes the advantage of vectorizing. Does that make sense? Okay, good. Let's go to the reparameterizing part. So the most common reparameterization, it is called a non-centered reparameterization. What does it mean? This means, well, suppose that we are interested in a normal distribution, just a generic term, right? So here, those are some thetas, and then they follow the mean theta and the sigma theta, and using a normal distribution. Great. We want to see, well, how can this be reparameterized? And if we do want to do some reparameterization, we want to know what is the direction of reparameterization. In other words, how can I do it? In which way I want to reparameterize it? So I can reparameterize normal distribution in many different alternatives. And what is actually the best one to reparameterize the distribution? So that means we need a target. We need a reference distribution, and we reparameterize our rather complex distribution relative to the target distribution. the reference. So what is a reference distribution here? So the reference is as simple as a standard normal distribution. So standard normal distribution is here, normal 0, 1. This is the standard normal distribution. This is Stan's favorite, okay? And if we could rewrite or reparameterize our distribution with respect to a standard normal distribution, and then the job is done. So our goal of the reparameterization is to rewrite our distribution with respect to a standard normal distribution. Okay, that's it. So this one, the blue theta tilted, let's say this follows the standard normal. And then the real theta in this pinkish red color, it is the actual theta that we are interested in. So we would like to rewrite the theta with respect to the theta tilted. Okay, good. So this one is standard normal. And what we want to do is basically we want to change the mu and we want to change the standard deviation. So multiplying a standard normal with the sigma basically change the width of the distribution, right? If this sigma is 2, and then this standard normal will become wider, and if this sigma is 0.5 or 0.1, and then the shape of the multiplication term will just be a little bit narrower, right? So basically multiplying with the theta, the sigma, sorry, multiplying with the sigma only changes the width of the distribution. Great. And then here, if you add a mu to this multiplication term, that basically changes the location on the x-axis. So if this one is positive, the distribution will be moving rightward. And if the mu is negative, then the distribution will move a little bit leftward to the negative side. Okay, so basically shifting on the x-axis, nothing else. And then this is already a good reparameterization with respect to the standard normal distribution. Okay, so I guess you're smart enough and everything is clear. And we see, well, this one and this one, they are equivalent. So reparameterization doesn't change the model. So you rewrite it to make everything equivalent, but with respect to the standard normal distribution. Okay, good, perfect. Yes, Stan likes simple distribution, and Stan's favorite is standard normal. Graphically, let's say if the blue curve is the standard normal, and then you first multiply with the theta, in this case, it becomes a little bit wider, and in this case, assuming the mu is positive, and then this shape of the distribution will just be shifted a little bit rightward so that they are equivalent. Good, I think that makes sense. And let's see how to implement it in Stan. So previously we have this one that is a direct attempt. And to reparameterize everything, we will reparameterize X and Y with respect to a standard normal distribution. And here we introduce two additional variables, one called X underscore rho and Y underscore rho. Both of them, they are the standard normal distribution. And how we reparameterize Y with respect to Y underscore rho is simply because the mean is 0, we do not have to have this part. We only have to do this multiplication. So we multiply a 3 to Y underscore rho. Similarly, we multiply this term, exp and the half of Y, multiply that with X underscore rho. In this case, both of X rho and Y rho, they are standard normal distribution. And we change the width of the distribution. There is no mean parameter. So mean is zero and everything is fine, everything is done. Great. And then you also have to see how the parameters are declared. So in the parameters block, we declare the simple parameters, here x row and y row. And then here we have to use the transformed parameters block to make the link, to link x with x row, to link here x, sorry, to link x with x row and to link y with y row. And then to write down the link. And then in the actual sampling part, we only sample from simple distributions. In other words, the standard normal distribution. Great. So what I show you is on the third column, this one, those are the parameter estimation results from STEM when we have used the optimization. So here with the reparameterization, the R hat is 1.0, perfect, and the number of effect samples nearly 4,000 out of 4,000, and the runtime also 50 seconds here. So the number of effect samples per time unit, this is a huge, you see here per second, nearly 80 samples relative to from before, well, nearly half a sample per time unit. And then graphically, this is most striking, right? You see every MC-MC chain, they mix pretty well so that we know there's no divergence and then the result is reliable. Okay, good. And then what is the middle part? So what is the thing? So I'm now telling you what is the middle part. If you run a STEM model, for example, and then if you run that as a first attempt, you will receive some warnings, presumably. And then the warning will tell you what to do. So in the previous example, we see that there were 97 divergent transitions after warm-up, and increasing the adapt delta might be helpful. So this is the suggestion from the warning message. And you might just wonder, what the heck does the delta mean? And occasionally you will also see some other suggestions and it might suggest you, well, increasing the maximum tree depth above 10 might solve the problem. And you might just wonder, okay, what is the tree depth? So in this table, I'm listing all those STEM internal parameters. So they are related to the MCMC acceptance rate, the step size, and also something like the tree depth. So they are STEM internal parameters that are used to optimize the sampling. So those are, so don't get confused. Those parameters here I show you, they are not the parameters in your model. Your model is your model, and those parameters are STEM specific, STEM internal parameters, okay? Commonly, we have four. So this one is the most straightforward one, iterations. How many samples do we need? So default is 2000, and you can change this one easily from 2000 to 3 to 4000. Here, these three, they are the sampling parameters. The delta, just this is the adapt delta. So they are just like the acceptance rate. So how likely that you would like to accept your proposal. And if we set this one, so this is basically a rate, a percentage. So if you say zero, then that means you will never accept your proposal. And if you say 100, that means you will accept every proposal. So by definition, not by definition, sorry. So by default, it is 0.8. And usually if you see the warning message, they tell you to increase from 0.8, you can say 0.9, 0.99. So usually those are the theoretical maximum. Don't do it one, don't say one, just say 0.999, that's okay. Step size, just the step size of the internal or initial Hamiltonian Monte Carlo step size. So step size by default is 2. And you can imagine, if you want your MC sampler to travel a little bit more fine-graded, how to change the step size. It's not surprising that we reduce the step size, right, to make it travel a little bit smaller piece by piece. And in this case, the sampling will be more fine-graded. So usually what we do is to decrease the step size relative to the delta. For the delta, we increase the delta. Okay, great. The third one is the maximum tree depthing. And then this one, I can't really give you a good intuition what that means. So it mostly means the maximum at HMC steps per iteration. And by default is 10. But intuition is more or less that, well, if you want to have a fine-graded sampling, you want to sample many times. So what to do is to increase it, increase the maximum tree depth. Okay, so practically, if we have some pathological modeling behavior from STEM, what we do, we increase the iterations, we increase the delta, we decrease the step size, and we might also have to increase the maximum tree depth. Okay? And practically in R, so how to do this kind of change? When we were calling the model, the iteration, the iter here, this means the iteration, we can change from 2000 to 4000. And we could have another additional input argument, which is called control, and we specify a data list where we give the altered depth delta and then the step size and also the maximum tree depth. So here in this case, we increase delta, we decrease step size, and we increase the maximum tree depth. Okay, good. So then I can explain what the middle plot shows. So here, this is the direct implementation. And here, it is also the direct implementation, but with increased adaptive delta, with a reduced step size, and also with a increased maximum tree depth. So here, with some adjustment, but also a direct implementation. So here you see, well, with all this kind of adjustment, we reduced the R-hat a little bit. We increased the number of effect samples, not too many. And the runtime is fine, and then the number of effect samples is also not really too promising, okay? And if you see, even though there is no number of divergent transitions, those trees plots, they don't really look fine. They are still very bad, okay? So this is why whenever you see you have 1.1, you have no number of divergence, don't feel very safe. So go to the trace plot and then see if they really look like something like this. If they do, fine, very good. If they do not, you have to change. And here together with all of the three graphs, what I'm also trying to show you is that making some adjustments. So here, those are the adjustments. So making some adjustments is not really it is not really the first thing you want to do, because even though you do it, as you could imagine, because we are trying to adjust to make it more fine-graded, it will take longer, right? And if we do it, and we know that it will take longer, but it is not guaranteed that it will improve the model. So adjustment is not the first thing to do. The first thing to do is to do optimization, to see if you can vectorize a lot, to see if you can reparameterize your distributions with respect to a standard normal distribution. And then if the optimization doesn't work well still, well, do some adjustment to increase some sample size, to decrease the step size, and then to increase the depth delta and something like that related. But usually it's not necessary. So when you optimize everything, it will be working well. Okay, good. A few more minutes and let's see another question. So in the end, we see that Reparameterizing is not really so difficult. We have a unit normal distribution and we reparameterize a normal distribution with respect to a standard normal. And then that's it, and nothing surprising, nothing really high tech. It's not really doing rocket science. And there's a small challenge in here, right? What is the small challenge? The challenge here is that, as we said, normal distribution, they have boundaries. They do not have boundaries. They have something just like from minus infinity to positive infinity. So this is the property of normal distribution. But from time to time in our models, we do have parameters that have boundaries, like the learning rate from 0 to 1, like the theta parameter in the binomial distribution, the success rate. It is also a parameter like the water-land distribution. It is also a parameter between 0 and 1. And how do we reparameterize bounded parameters, okay? So those are the standard normal reparameterization. And the theta here, no boundary. If we do want to have some boundaries, what we do is like we have to apply some transformation so that the transformed parameter will be bounded. So what kind of transformation you have in mind to transfer here to something like 0, 1 ranged parameter? So the solution is actually we can use softmax. So softmax is really a generic function. It doesn't really apply only to choice in our model. It is just like a transformation curve, right? Like logic. And the inputs arguments on the x-axis of the softmax is negative infinity to positive infinity. And then the y-axis is 0 to 1. Great, so then we have a excellent transformation to translate everything into a 0, 1 range parameter. Okay, good. So here, this probably the minor thing is basically the softmax, another way to term it. So it is actually the cumulative normal distribution curve, but don't worry about that. The shape is like this. And inside of the parentheses, that is the reparameterization, where we do not have a boundary. And after the transformation here, this theta really has a proper range between 0 and 1. And then we solve the problem. So now we know how to use reparameterization for a bounded parameter. And next you might just wonder, we do not want to have 0, 1. We have, 0, 3, 0, 4, 0, 10, and we want to make it more generalizable. And how to do it? This is simple, because if we have boundary 0, 1, if we want to have boundary 0, 3, we simply multiply a 3 here, and then the range becomes 0, 1, 2, 0, 3. So here, this table is pretty important. And this shows you the common ways to reparameterize parameter. Here, this one is with no range, we do this way, and then this row means when we want to have a parameter with a lower bound of 0 and with an upper bound of capital N. So here we apply this property here, this is this curve, and inside, that's the reparameterization, and we multiply with N. So then we know the range. And if you want to generalize that a little bit more, so instead of from 0 to n, you want to have from any lower end and to any upper end, this is also easy because, well, we can simply multiply with the distance between n and m, and then plus the lower end. And you know this like a shifting thing, right? You know how that works. And in some other scenarios, you do not have a upper end, and you only have a lower end from 0 to something positive infinity. Well, in this case, what you can do is to apply this exponent, because this, by definition, takes any value positive, and there is no upper boundary. And anything inside here, well, you do the regular reparameterization. And if you want to have something from negative infinity to 0, well, then just have a minus sign in front of it, then you have everything. In this case, you could reparameterize nearly 99.99% of the parameters in the STEM model. Okay, Good. Any questions? But this one we can do it next time. I show you this, I will give you the slides and then you can take a look how this can be applied in our hierarchical model. So we do the same idea. So we have the simple distribution, 0, 1, standard normal distribution, and we write the link how the individual level parameters are associated with group level parameters. And also we will have to give proper prior distributions in the sense that we give simple standard normal distributions. Okay, good. Questions? Yeah, I've given you slides until here. Yeah, here is quite prominent. So those are the hierarchical fitting without the optimization. You see here, those distributions, they don't really look good. So they are quite sparse. And with the hierarchical model, with optimization, we see, well, they are just the nice and the continuous distribution that we love to see. And here there's some comparison that I can share you the slides and everything's fine. Good. Questions? Yeah, so there's a question regarding the exercise, the program exercise. Yes. Oh, you mean the exercise, wait, on the slides. Ah, I see. Wait. Yeah, this. I will send you the slides, you will see that, okay? The exercise is that there is a nearly complete but incomplete STEM model with the optimization and follow what we have covered during class and then complete that model and see how that runs. See how that runs is really not important. Completing that model is more important. Any other questions?